chickadees. How are you? We're going to sing a song again. And this is a song that, well, we haven't sung for a while because you haven't been here. So let's sing together. I'm going to sing, sing, sing. And there's a shout part. I'm going to sing, sing, sing. I'm going to shout, shout, shout. Okay, so remember to shout, okay? Tammy's going to help me. Oops, wrong key. I'm going to sing, sing, sing. Shout, shout, shout. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna
shout.
Praise the Lord.
When those gates are open
wide, I'm gonna
sing, Jesus.
I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout.
Praise the Lord.
Do it again,
son.
I'm gonna sing,
sing, sing. I'm gonna
shout,
shout, shout. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout.
Praise the Lord. Good. That was fun, wasn't it? Come back again next week and we'll have another one.
Well, happy Sabbath. I'm glad to see you again. So today we are still talking about the gentleness of God. And so remember last week we associated the strawberries with the word gentleness, the way God is gentle. So I hope you went out and ate a bunch of strawberries. And when you eat those strawberries and you taste that goodness, you just know that Jesus is the most gentle, loving Savior we will ever have. Okay? So let's start out with prayer. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much for bringing us together again. We thank you for the stories that you have for us, Lord, for all the care that you give us and how gentle you are with us. In Jesus' name, amen. So today we're talking about some sheep. Here's some sheep. And these animals are known as being very gentle. If you ever feel their fur, the wool, it's very soft and it's very warm and it keeps you very warm in the winter. And these are sheep. But sheep need a shepherd. Who is our shepherd? Who is your shepherd? Our shepherd is Jesus. And he is a very gentle shepherd. And he cares so much for his sheep that if one were to be lost, oh no. Look at all these sheep that are left. And one is missing, Jesus will go and search for that sheep. He'll go and search for that little lamb, high and low. He will go and he will look everywhere, everywhere, high and low. He will look everywhere for that little lost lamb. Jesus will not let one little lamb get away. So when he finds that little lamb, he's so happy, he's so excited, and he brings that little lamb home, and all the other sheep are there, and he takes care of them. We're like that little lamb. Jesus comes looking for us. He will not let us go. I am so thankful for that. I'm so thankful that Jesus will never let me go. And he is so gentle with me. He says, "Where have you been? I've come to look for you." And he brings me home. I hope that you will always be Jesus' little lamb. And Jesus will always go looking for you. He would never let you any harm come to you. What about you? What if you were a shepherd? Would you let a little lamb be harmed? Look at those little lambs. What if it ran out into the street? Would you go get it? Would you save that little lamb? Yes, a good shepherd always takes care of his little lambs. So let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much for being our shepherd. We thank you so much, Lord, that every time that we are lost, you come looking for us. That you will always bring us home, Lord. You will always be by our side. You make sure, Lord, that not one of us is lost. You keep coming after us, Lord, and I am so thankful for that. And so when you come, and we will all be your sheep, and we will follow you home. In Jesus' name, amen. So don't forget our memory verse. We said it was found in Ephesians 4:2. And 4:2 says, be completely humble and gentle. So we want to be more like Jesus. Okay? So we're still painting, like last week, with the daubers. But I wanted to show you there's different ways too, because it's round. So sometimes when it's round, it's hard to paint with. But if you kind of roll it on its side, it'll give it some different lines. So if you roll it, it'll paint different. So there's some spaces that you might not be able to get into real good with the round part of this. And then you get close to the line there and you roll it and it'll give it some lines. Well, that one's a little messy. These are lots of fun to paint with. And you can find these pretty much anywhere. I think even at the Dollar Tree. I hope you have a wonderful Sabbath.
Greetings and welcome to True Life Community Seventh-day Adventist Church today. We're so glad that you could join us. I want to thank Tammy for our children's story and for singing, for letting me help her sing the song today for the kids. She and Robert are going to be doing our songs today. They're going to be starting with Because He Lives, and then they're going to give our final special also. So we're going to talk a little bit more about prophecy today from the book of Daniel. So sit back and listen, and we hope you enjoy it.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. And I see His hand of mercy I hear his voice of cheer, and every time I need him, he is always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujah. Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Walks with me and he talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds a future. In life is worth the living just because he lives.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
Talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. You ask me how I know he lives.
Reading this morning is taken from the book of Ezra. We don't hear much from Ezra, but I want to read from his book today, chapter 4, because it deals with the restoring and rebuilding of Jerusalem and the temple in Jerusalem by the Jews who were sent back there. And it's we're told about it in the book of Daniel. And I'm dealing with the book of Daniel today. We're dealing with prophecy again. And in Ezra chapter 4, beginning with verse 1, we read these words. Now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity, that is the Jews, were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel, and the heads of the fathers' houses said to them, "Let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do, and we have sacrificed to him since the days of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria, who brought us here. But Zerubbabel and Jeshua and the rest of the heads of the fathers' houses of Israel said to them, you may do nothing with us to build a house for our God, but we alone will build to the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us. Then the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in building and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So we're going to be talking a little bit more about that later, but I want to talk to you about Bible prophecy. I want to set up a little, some ground rules, because we need to know a little bit about Bible prophecy before we continue. When we speak about prophetic things, prophetic terms in Daniel Revelation, we must remember and really put to practice the important rules to follow. First of all, in Bible prophecy, a day equals a year. Therefore, we conclude that a week of prophecy, 7 days, equals 7 days or 7 years. Remember that a year equals 360 days instead of the 364 or 5 that we deal with today. Then remember that all the months of prophecy, the months, equal 30 days. There are 12 months, 30 days each month, 360 again. We must add a year when we go from BC to AD. So remember, we add a year because there was no year zero. That's another rule. We must realize that all prophecies deal with Jesus. In one respect or another, they deal with the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus. Jesus is the center of everything that is mentioned in his word and in the Bible. And we should also realize that some prophecies have dual applications. That is, they might have been fulfilled back in the Old Testament or in the New Testament, but they also may apply to something that's going to happen yet in our future. So those are some of the rules. In the 70-week prophecy, God is actually warning his people, the Jews, that they have about 490 years to straighten up their act. They have been doing everything that they possibly can to frustrate the Lord God in his leading them and trying to get them to follow him. And Gabriel says in Daniel 9, verse 24, 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish transgression. So they've been transgressing. They need to finish that. To make an end of sins. That's the same thing, to make an end of sin. To make reconciliation for iniquity, that's the same thing, ask God to forgive you. To bring in everlasting righteousness, to bring righteousness into your life. And I think probably that's dealing with Jesus is going to appear, bringing in everlasting righteousness. To seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the Most Holy. Daniel 9, verse 24. So the Jews had wandered a long ways from where God wanted them to be. They were worshiping weird things and in weird ways. Let's review for just a few moments the early parts of the 70-week prophecy that we talked about a couple, 3 weeks ago, because it's important that we know where it started, when it started, and how it started. What was the sign of the beginning of the 70-week prophecy? So we can arrive correctly and understand the conclusions and can really understand that the Bible is God's truth, and it is his word, it is promise to us. First, we need to know the beginning date of the 70-week prophecy. Daniel tells us that the angel Gabriel told him that something very significant would happen to indicate the beginning of the 70-week prophecy. And what was that? What was that incident? That incident was the command, just as in Ezra, we just read for our scripture, that was the command to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem and the temple. It had been destroyed. When that would happen, then we know that it was the beginning of the 70-week prophecy. We also know that there were several commands to build and restore Jerusalem. There were kings that came along and commanded and made rules or commands for the Jews to return, but none of them really worked until Artaxerxes came along, and he was the king, and that final command was given by King Artaxerxes, because he not only gave the commandment, but he also sent the people and equipment and their families and things down to Jerusalem for them to rebuild, and sent gold and silver and everything. And so let's read in the book of Ezra, and he tells us about it. It says, so the elders of the Jews built, and they prospered through the prophesying of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the son of Iddo. And they built and finished it according to the commandment of the God of Israel and according to the command of Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes, king of Persia. That's found in Ezra chapter 6, verse 14. We know from history and the Bible that the reign of Artaxerxes began in 465 BC, and that it was in the eighth year of his reign, which is 457 BC, that he made this decree. And he sent the men and their supplies and actually allowed the Jews to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild the city as well as the temple. Now, an intriguing part of the 70-week prophecy is found in Daniel 9, verse 25. What makes it so intriguing is that the 70-week prophecy is divided into three parts. So remember that. The first part of the 70-week prophecy begins with the portion of time that is equal to 7 weeks. How long is 7 weeks? 7 weeks times 7 days per week is 49 days or years. So the first part is seven weeks, times seven is 49 years. In Daniel 9:25, Gabriel speaks these words. He says, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem," that was in 457, "until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks." So there's two parts right there, 7 weeks and 62 weeks. "And the street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublesome times." We know that the adversaries came in, they were trying to confound the Jews to not so they wouldn't build the Jerusalem and rebuild the temple. So if we multiply 7 weeks times seven, each week has 7 days, we come to 49 years. So something special must have happened after 49 years, after 457, when this 457 BC, we're talking BC now, something must have happened in 49 years. And we find out that the whole thing was built, Jerusalem and the temple was rebuilt in 49 years. So that takes us to 408 BC. The second part of the 70-week prophecy is the 62-week part. Something special must be a signal for the fulfillment of the 62 weeks, the second part of the 70 weeks that come after the 7 weeks that we've just considered. So the 62 weeks come after 408 BC. If we take 62 weeks times 7 days in a week, we come up with 434 years or days. So it's actually years. Now, a fascinating thing happens. We have crossed from BC to AD. Remember what we do now? We add a year because there's no year zero. So we've crossed over from BC to AD when we add 62 weeks together, and it crosses over into AD or in the new calendar, the way it's the birth of Jesus and the beginning of a new calendar. If we subtract 408 BC from 434, we'll come up with 26 AD. But remember that we must add a year because there's no year zero. So we come up with 27 AD. It means we come to 27 AD, which is the year that Jesus was baptized. So that is a great and a marvelous thing that happened to end this second part, the 62 weeks or 434 years. So we can read about that in the book of Acts, chapter 10, where it says clearly that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, because God was with him. So here we have Jesus, who was not only baptized in 27, but he was anointed. What does anointed mean? Well, it means the same thing as Christ. You know, when you say Jesus Christ, you're not saying his first name and his last name. You're saying Jesus, the anointed one, or Jesus, the one who was anointed and given a mission by God the Father. Jesus, the anointed one. So the reason this part is so important, the second part, is because it refers to the year that Jesus was anointed. that he became this missionary or this person who was going to do God's will perfectly. Jesus was baptized in 27 AD, so we see that the prophecy is right on time and right on target. So now we have reached the beginning of the 70th week. What happens at the beginning of the 70th week? Well, Jesus is baptized. He's anointed by the Holy Spirit. The dove comes down. The Father says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." And he's anointed. I might add right here that many Christian theologians and preachers and evangelists place this seven-year period in all kinds of places in history. But if you do that, then you're tearing it apart from the 70 weeks and you're putting it somewhere else, and there's no instruction for us to do that. There's no logical reason for doing that, especially since we know very well that the prophecy fits together with all the other 69 weeks in Daniel. There's no indication that this seven-year period should be separated from the other 434 years. Daniel is simply telling us that the seven-year period is the last 7 years of the 490 that have been prophesied. So, what all happens in this seven-year period now that we're talking about, the third part of the 70-week prophecy? What all happens? It must be pretty earth-shattering, or it would not have been made into such a separate individual section of the 70 weeks, the vital period of time. So let's take a look at the final 7 years, that final week of the 490 years, or the 70 weeks. We have already discussed the end of the 69 weeks. The end happened when Jesus was baptized, when he was anointed, when he became baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist in 27 AD. But then the Bible adds these somewhat kind of cryptic words. We have to kind of decipher them about that final 7 years. It says, after 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be a flood until the end of war of desolations are determined. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of that week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. Boy, there's a lot of weird kind of words and kind of language in there. Now you know why I called it the kind of cryptic, but I want you to understand that when we take the words apart and kind of bring it down to our language, it's very easy to understand. We know, for instance, that the 62 weeks added to the 7 weeks is 69 weeks. We now also know that the end of the 69 weeks was the baptism of Jesus in AD 27. We know that it was 27 AD because of Luke chapter 3, verses 1, 2, and 3, where it gives us a whole line of a whole group of people who are rulers. There's kings, there's high priests, there's governors, and we know when they ruled. History tells us when they ruled. So we know that it was 27 AD when Jesus was baptized. We are also told that the Messiah was cut off sometime after the 69 weeks. It wasn't right at the end of the 69 weeks. It marked the end of the 69 weeks, but it also marked the beginning of the 70th week. So we know that it must be during the 70th week that a lot of stuff begins to happen. Look at verse 27 in Daniel 9. The angel relates to Daniel with these words. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of that week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Most Seventh-day Adventists know exactly what that first part is talking about. It means the one who was anointed, that is Jesus, shall teach and preach and live the gospel to the Jews for a week, but he's going to be cut off in the middle of that week after his baptism. But
we also know that Jesus, we also know from that that Jesus didn't live that whole 7 years. Daniel says that in the middle of the 70th week, this anointed one, Jesus, will bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Two questions arise from those few words. First of all, what does it mean that he will bring an end to the sacrificial system? Well, we know that Jesus became the Lamb of God that took away the sins of the world. So we know that he took away the sacrificial system that the Jews had performed for thousands of years throughout the whole Old Testament. They were killing lambs. Well, those lambs pointed toward the Lamb of God that took away the sins of the world, which was Jesus. And so that's the beginning of this this 70th week that we're talking about. Jesus was going to be baptized. Now, in the middle of that week, he was going to be cut off. That is, he was going to put an end to the sacrificial system. In the middle of that week, 27 AD, he was baptized. In 31 exactly, right in the middle, just 3.5 years later, he was crucified on the cross. He became the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He was slain in the middle of that week. It was because he had taught his disciples. How did Jesus confirm the covenant with many for a whole week when he was cut off in the middle of that week? That's the second question. The first question was, how did he do away with the sacrificial system? Well, he died on the cross. The second question is, how did he confirm the covenant with many, that is, preach the gospel, teach the gospel, live the gospel, for a whole week if he was cut off in the middle of that week? Well, it's because he taught his disciples and his followers so well that they would declare the gospel to the Jews even when Jesus was gone. So in that way, he sent the Holy Spirit, remember? He said, when I go away, I'll send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will be with you wherever you go. So he confirmed the covenant with many. He taught the gospel for that whole week, even though he was gone. So now we must find out what happened exactly 3.5 years after that, that is, after Jesus was crucified, or in 34 AD, that made his sacrifice in the middle of that week. If you understand what I'm saying, it had to be 3.5 years after his crucifixion that something dramatic had to happen. In order for this prophecy to hold water, it must be something pretty drastic that happened exactly 3.5 years after Jesus was crucified. If he was crucified in the fall of 31 AD and 3.5 years later, it's 34 AD. So what happened in 34 AD? So happened in 34 AD that was so significant that it was the end of that 70th week. Remember that I mentioned at the start that God was giving the Jewish people 490 years of probation. They were going to, it was time for them to turn around, and God wanted them to turn their lives around to worship him as he has asked them to. And he's given them 490 years to make that all happen. The great nation that God wanted them to be was not what was happening. And he wanted them to be a great nation. If they could not become all that God wanted them to be, then the gospel would then go to the rest of the world, to the Gentiles of the world. I mean, the people that were not Jewish. And God's saving grace would be given to the Gentile world. That's why you and I are in God's family. He's adopted us. In the book of Acts, we have the very deed. We have the very action that sealed the fate of the Jewish people. Listen to Acts chapter 7. In this story of the brave, there is a brave man named Stephen. He is preaching to the Jews, and he says these things, and he's not very kind to them, but he's telling them the truth. He says, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the just one, of Jesus, of whom you now have become the betrayers and murderers. You have murdered Jesus, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have not kept it." Acts 7, verses 51 through 53. Those were harsh words presented by Stephen to the Jews, and those words made the Jewish men so angry that they took Stephen out and they stoned him to death. Stephen died a martyr, but his dying words were the same as those that Jesus uttered when he died. It says in Acts 7, verse 60, then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Acts 7, verse 60. The final deadly action by the Jewish men was an action that turned the gospel, over to the Gentiles. And Saul, a man who would later become Paul, who would later become the greatest missionary besides Jesus himself, Saul was standing there and he was witnessing Stephen being stoned. And he was there when Stephen died. And of course, later on, Saul, his name was changed to Paul, and he became a great missionary for the Lord Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. Then in the book of Romans, after Saul's name had been changed to Paul, it speaks about his mission with these words, because of the grace given to me, Paul says, because of the grace given to me by God, that I might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God. Romans 15, verses 15 and 16. So Daniel was given a glimpse of the future of his people. These prophecies should help each of us to see that the Bible is truth, and it's the word of God, because God has control of all of history. He has control of our world. He knows the end from the beginning, and he has prophesied to help us to understand that his word right here, his Bible, is truth, and we should spend time in it and study it, read it, make it a part of our lives every day. I hope that you've enjoyed this presentation on that 70th week of Daniel's 70-week prophecy. We're going to end our service now with a song by Robert and Tammy entitled, No Matter What.
A lot of us grew up believing at any moment we could lose it all. And at the drop of a hat, God might turn his back and move on. A lot of us feel like we blew it, thinking that we're just too far gone. But I want you to know there's still a hope for you. Not separated, no matter what.
There's never been a better time to get honest. There's never been a better time to get clean. So come as you are and run to the cross and be free. Oh, be free.
No matter what.
No matter what.
you enjoyed the presentation of the 70-week prophecy of Daniel. We'll continue later on. We have some other topics that we want to discuss the next two or three Sabbaths, but we'll continue with prophecy as we go through this year. Thank you for being here today. We hope that you have a wonderful week ahead of you. Let's begin that week as we end this one with a word of prayer. Father, I just bow in your presence to thank you for the book of Daniel. Such a wonderful book to understand. I know that it's deep. I know that it's confusing at times in its language. But help us, Lord, as we go through this book of Daniel, that we'll begin to understand his language and his culture. Be with us now through this coming week. Keep us safe. Help us to come back again next week. In Jesus' name, amen.